We are going to talk about evaluation of echo in aortic stenosis, what all echocardiographic images we should take, what all parameters we should evaluate so that we come to a perfect conclusion. And that's what we are going to show you in this series of echo training programs. First parameters what you'll take in the subject of population is, we take an M mode across aorta, LA and AV cusp separations. In the beginning, I like to say this is what a drop method we have invented. You drop a line right into the center of this sector. What starts intersecting at the aortic valve, keep the 2D image static. Move your cursor at the tip of the mitral valve leaflets and then just distal to the tip of mitral valve leaflets. And when mitral valve disappears, we are almost able to see our LV measurements. These measurements have been modified and has been incorporated along with the various measurements of American Society of Echocardiography or European Association of Echocardiography. We evaluated these measurements in almost more than 200 subjects. We found the difference of only 1 millimeter when we use this particular method. And ASC, as well as European Association of Echocardiography, says we should take 2 dimensions measurements. But I'll say the measurement across LV, if we take in M mode, there's a frame rate of almost 1,000 frames per second, and we are able to drive much better measurements rather than 2D measurements. Let me go ahead and measure these measurements. Here is left ventricular interventricular septum during diastole and a posterior wall during diastole. Similarly, we take a septum during systole and a posterior wall during systole. Most important thing is we are able to look at the IVS during diastole as well as systole. Similarly, is left ventricular posterior wall during diastole and systole. We store these measurements, get rid of our measurements, and then move retro in the back so that we are able to evaluate a very good M mode evaluations. And what all M mode is, we need to look at a DE excursion and subsequently is EF slope. And we keep these measurements, go back further on the scroll of this trackball, and we try to evaluate what is aorta is. Here is aorta, here is LA dimensions, here is aortic valve opening. And take my words, when we evaluated all these measurements, there was hardly a variation of 1 to 2 millimeters. But subsequently, when these measurements were given to all other subjects to measure in this particular fashion, they have a very high level of intra-operator coincidence or intra-operative non-variability of the measurements. They were, again, I'll say, they had hardly any measurements difference of 1 or 2 millimeters. Second is, in aortic valve evaluation, what we need to measure is LVOT diameter, and that's what I'm going to utilize the parasternal shock traces view, parasternal long axis view at aorta. And I'm going to measure my parasternal long axis view at aorta by taking a clip and then freezing it, and to get a maximum diameter across LVOT. Various people have said various things, and what we adopt in our lab is, we'll go 1 to 2 millimeters from a hinge point into the LVOT. Similarly, we'll go 1 to 2 millimeters a hinge point from aortic valve insertion, and then at those points, we'll like to take an LVOT diameter. And this LVOT diameter for this particular subject is almost 2.1 centimeters. Third aspects, what we look in the subjects of population is, we go and switch on the colors and look how much is the turbulence across aortic valve. And if you look at this subject, there's hardly any turbulence aortic valve or mitral valve, thereby suggesting there's no aortic stenosis. Similarly, we rotate a transducer clockwise. And aorta being in the center, LA over here, RA over here, tricuspid valve, RV outflow tract over here, and then pulmonic artery divided into right and left pulmonic artery. We can very well see an aortic valve. And in this particular aortic valve, obviously we cannot do a perimeterization, as many people they often say. Why can't we do it? I say the answer is we do not have enough correlationship when we do catheter studies to look for aortic valve involvement. Once we have done this kind of an imaging, what we go and evaluate the apical four chamber view. Couple of measurements which are of lot of value for apical four chamber view is, the first and foremost measurement in apical four chamber view is to look for LV function, and look at this LV function in this particular subject. Four chamber view, and then we look at a two chamber view. Acquire the image. And third is the three chamber view. And once we have done all these acquisitions, we can come to a definite ejection fraction in this subset of populations. I'm acquiring again a three chamber view. Now I go back and let's look at the gradients which are available across aortic valve and LVOT in the subjects. I'm evaluating gradients across aortic valve. First, I'll use a sample volume to be kept at LVOT. And this sample volume, once we keep at LVOT, I'm going to measure an LVOT VTI. Reduce the gain a little bit. Make a spectrum absolutely crisp. Let the person hold his breath. And once we have done that, what we do is we measure LVOT diameter, LVOT VTI. Measuring an LVOT VTI, we have to just trace an LVOT VTI. Looking at how much is the VTI of this particular subject across LVOT is. And if you happen to look, this is what the LVOT VTI is, 20.6. We have an LVOT VTI, we have an LVOT diameter. Based on this, we can come across how much is the stroke volume for this subject of population. Then third subject comes, aortic valve flow across aortic valve. And now I'm going to keep my sample volume just distal to the tip of aortic valve leaflets. Switch on the colors, switch on a continuous wave Doppler, and then let's see how much is a aortic valve VTI. In this subject, it is normal. Everybody knows about it. But once the valve is stenotic, you'll find a very high turbulent flow velocity across these subset of populations. And I'm going to trace aortic valve flow pattern so that I'm going to get a VTI across aortic valve. And that's aortic valve VTI is. And in this subject, it is again 25.3. I'll save this picture to come back again. With this, we can come to many conclusions, like we can have a dimensionless index, and that is division of LVOT VTI with aortic valve VTI. We can calculate a stroke volume. I can calculate peak and mean gradients across aortic valve. Another couple of things which are really of importance as far as aortic valve stenosis evaluation is concerned today, we always look for parameters like strain imaging. In this subset of population, whether the strain is normal or abnormal, and why do we do that is we want to look for a subclinical LV dysfunction. And it may be a subject where the function may be normal or things appears to be normal as far as their LV function is concerned. In this subject, we have these six patterns across the six segments in apical long axis view, showing that the minimum strain is of green segment, and this green segment belongs to basal posterior wall in 16 segment module, and even that strain value is almost 19, minus 19. And if you take a cutoff point of 17, or some people say 18, this strain values are normal. Similarly, we go for a four chamber view, apply a four chamber fraction strain imaging, and once we look at the strain imaging, we look at again six segments of the aortic valve LV, and here we can find out one particular segment has a strain which is of red of color, is a basal lateral wall, which is mildly reduced. and then going to store this image and look at the two chamber view to have the stain values across the two chamber view in the anterior wall and an inferior wall. And if I look at this stain value for interior inferior wall, I have to go and recalculate again, because this is what is not showing a correct values of a basal inferior segments. And once we process this again, and how things comes up. Now you can look at this, whatever we saw in a couple of minutes back, this basal lateral wall has got a mildly reduced 2D stain. But if you look at a global longitudinal stain for this subject, average of that is 24.2 minus, and which is very well within normal limits. And couple of patients where we have an LV hypertrophy, LV function may be par normal, that may be more than normal, but they have a reduced 2D stain, suggesting that possibly the people have started developing a subclinical LV dysfunction. Now the question comes, if I have an aortic stenosis, which all windows I should utilize? I say we should utilize at least 5 windows, and I like to demonstrate one window which has been derived by a giraffe. We have been traditionally using apical 3 chamber view, apical 5 chamber view. Then we are using an right parasternal window, then the suprasternal window and a subcostal window. And I'd like to show you one window which we have been started utilizing, and what's discovered by chance is, let the person lie down flat on his back. And what we did is we put a pillow on behind his right shoulder, so bring it up a little wise and extend his neck. And when we extended his neck in this particular position, and when we put a probe right across it, we saw a great window, which you labeled at later on as right anterior oblique view. And in this particular window, when we use in the right anterior oblique view, we could see a great deal of ascending aorta. Now you can see whole of the ascending aorta on this side of a screen. And if I'll rotate this patient a little bit on the right hand side, my whole of the aorta would be seen in a much better way. And this view was, if you look at my screen on the right side, left side of a screen, you could see a whole of the ascending aorta which is seen in this particular view. And when we utilized this window, we were able to get a much better gradient than any time other way. And these were helpful for evaluation of aortic valve stenosis. If I have to compile everything in one subject or in one topic to say in conclusion, what all we look for LV hypertrophy, we look for LVOT diameter, we look at peak and mean gradient across aortic valve utilizing all 6 windows, including drops, right anterior oblique view. Then we look at an LVOT VTI, take a dimensionless index, and calculate stroke volume along with 2D strain across LV. And by this, we can really classify what kind of aortic stenosis it is and what should be our management over a period of time.